Please remain standing for the entrance of the Colour Party, which this morning is comprised of members of First Air Scouts. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please be seated. A warm welcome to everyone who is worshiping with us this morning, those who are here in person and those who will be joining us later online. And thanks also to those who are present to help us remember and recognize Air's Remembrance Sunday, which by tradition is a week ahead of everyone else's. It's because we're a forward-thinking bunch. That's all right, because in my home part of Scotland, they celebrate Halloween the Friday night before. It's called Killeen, which is the nickname of the neighboring big town, Kilmarnock, is Killy. And Killeween happens not on Halloween, but on the Friday before. And it's believed it dates back to it was a big industrial city at one point, and it dates back to the early days of industry and labor, and the kids quickly figured out that the men came home with their pay packets on Friday, and if they were going to go out trick-or-treating, there would actually be some treats on Friday. If they waited to Halloween, it would be all gone. And to this day, they still do Halloween on the Friday before Halloween, much to the relief of local school teachers who don't have to deal with kids' eye on candy in the middle of the week. This morning, excuse me, we will proceed through the opening liturgy, which will lead us almost directly into our act of remembrance and following the order printed in the bulletin. There will not be a children's time as such, but I will make a few comments along the way at an appropriate time. And following the act of remembrance, younger members of the congregation, if they wish, may go to Pray Ground, where they'll do some remembrance-related crafts. Thank you all for many people who have given good wishes and asked about my trip to Iqaluit, which was because our daughter had surgery. Her partner, who's a Crown prosecutor, was going on circuit with the court, which there doesn't have cases come to it because of the difficulties of travel in the north. The court goes out and about to the outports, and the surgery and the court being on circuit coincided. And so with five young kids at home, I was the nearest available grandparent capable of lifting, lugging, and driving. So no, it was not a vacation, but it was wonderful to see the grandkids. We have one announcement that I'm aware of, and that is that the worship committee is actively looking for volunteers in a wide number of roles, helping with the offering, serving at communion, readers, helping with the audiovisual controls at the back of the church, a whole lot of things. And if you would like to look at those lists, there are or will be, sign-up sheets at the back of the church and also down in the hall with all of the various things that we could use volunteers to help with there. So please have a look, and if you can help, put down your name. You will be asked on a rotational basis, so don't worry, you're not serving up for every week of the year for the rest of your life. It is an occasional volunteer event. After the service, there will be lunch following in the hall. And this week, it's, what kind of lunch are we having today? A pastor lunch today, thank you. Are there any other announcements? Seeing none, would you please stand as we begin our opening liturgy? Please note that there is a sung response. The choir begins, and then the congregation joins in. God is our refuge and strength. And I will take you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of my hand. We are met this day to glorify God, whose power and love sustain the world, to remember with thanksgiving those who lived and those who died in the service of our country. We light this candle today in remembrance of those who served and as a sign that we stand in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. Amen, and please be seated. And let us come before God in prayer, and let us pray. Eternal God, you are the shepherd of our souls, and the giver of life everlasting. And so we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving, offering ourselves anew to you in love and in service. But we come also acknowledging our sins and our shortcomings. And so, merciful and faithful God, whose purpose is to fold both heaven and earth into a single peace, free of sin and death.
That in our hearts we keep alive the passions and pride that lead to hatred and war. We are not worthy of your great love, nor of the sacrifice made by others
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Beloved, hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Would you please rise for the call to remembrance? Let us remember the kindness of God and his favor to us in time of need. Let us remember the courage, devotion to duty, and the self-sacrifice of the men and women in our armed forces. The toil, endurance, and suffering of those who were not in uniform. The support of those who sent help from afar and came and stood by our side. Let us remember those who were wounded in the fight, those who perished in air raids, those who fell in battle and are buried at sea, or in some corner of a foreign field, and especially those whom we have known and loved, whose place is forever in our hearts. Let us remember those who were our enemies, whose homes and hearts are as bereft as ours, whose dead lie also in a living tomb of everlasting remembrance. Let us remember those who came back, those whose lives still bear the scars of war, those who lost sight or limbs or reason, those who lost faith in God and hope for humanity. Let us remember the continuing grace of God, whose love holds all souls in life, and to whom none is dead, but all are alive forevermore. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. The going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
Thank you.
Let us pray. In memory of those who served and those who died, may we be better men and women, better members of our community, and better citizens of our nation, Canada. Amen. The National Anthem. Please be seated. There isn't a children's time as such in the order of service this morning, but I wanted to take a moment to share something with you that is important to my wife Kathy and to me. Kathy is the youngest in her family, so her father was old enough to serve in the Second World War. In fact, he was one of those who lied about his age and enlisted before he was old enough to go to war, right at the beginning. And he served from the very beginning to the very end. He was building a Bailey Bridge across a canal in Holland when peace was declared, at which all of the men working on the bridge threw their tools into the air. You can guess where they landed. They were then ordered to get into the canal, retrieve all of the tools, and continue building the bridge. I'm by far the eldest in my family, and the son of my father, who is the youngest in his family of 11. So he was a young teenager during the war. Kathy's father brought back a handful of souvenirs, and one of them was this, one of the bullets fired at him that missed on while they were liberating Holland. One of the things that I hold precious, you can pass that around if you like, so long as I get it back, because my wife will kill me if I don't get it back. A little startlingly, about a good 30 or so years later, the West African country of Liberia was in the midst of a terrible civil war, which stutters on and off for decades. And at the height of that war, when there were more than one side fighting and ordinary people just sheltering in their homes and hoping for the best, and they were still using those kinds of bullets a generation later, one young man, seeing all of the streets around his home littered with the casings of those bullets, had an idea. He was a member of the Presbyterian Church in Liberia, which has a major American Presbyterian presence because it was founded by American slaves who left after liberation and founded a new state in East Africa called Liberia, Latin for liberation. He went out and he picked up all the shell casings, and with some very rudimentary tools, He shaped them into this. This is one of his. And he began to hand them out as a sign of peace and of that biblical promise that one day swords and spears would be turned into plowshares or even bullets into crosses, as a sign of the hope that even there in Liberia, the war would end and the bullets would have no more purpose other than to provide metal to make crosses. Sadly, he's still making bullet crosses in Liberia. Now they help raise money to work for peace. They are always a reminder to me of the point of remembrance. Remembrance isn't just about looking backwards. It is to urge us to look forwards, that we do better and we do more in the days that lie ahead. And you can share that. You'll all be frisked at the door if I don't get it back. That will be our theme through this whole service, that remembrance is meaningless unless it somehow urges, equips, and pushes us to do more and to do better. Let us pray. Loving God, whose Son is Prince of Peace, we pray that as we reflect upon the terrible cost of war, that we have laid upon us the burden, not only of sacrifice and remembrance, but the obligation to do better in our time and place in honor of those who gave so much. Amen. The young children can go with Tiffany, and I don't know if they're going to the table or they're going out. Sandra Ball is our reader this morning. Sandra.
Good morning. Please join me in saying the prayer for understanding together. As we turn to the guidance of your word, send down your Holy Spirit upon us, O God. Open our eyes that we may see your truth. Open our ears that we might hear your good news. And open our hearts that we may believe through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Choir sings the refrain for us, and then we will repeat it, and then we will continue with Psalm number 46.
God is our refuge and strength,
a very present help in trouble.
Therefore, we will not fear though that the earth should quake and the mountains fall into the depths of the sea.
Though the waters of the sea rage and foam, and the mountains tremble at the tumult.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, sanctifying the dwelling of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help at the break of day.
Nations are in tumult. Empires are shaken. For God speaks, and the earth melts away. Come and see what God has done, the wonders wrought upon the earth.
God makes wars to cease in all the world. God breaks the bow and snaps the spear, and burns the shields in the fire.
Be still and know that I am God.
Exalted among the nations, exalted in the earth.
The God of hosts is with us.
The God of Jacob is our refuge.
Reading from Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 9 to 14. Only be careful and watch yourselves closely so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen, or let them fade from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to their children after them. Remember the day you stood before the Lord your God at Horeb, when he said to me, "Assemble the people before me to hear my words, so that they may learn to revere me as long as they live in the land, and may teach them to their children." You came near and stood at the foot of the mountain while it blazed with fire to the very heavens, with black clouds and deep darkness. Then the Lord spoke to you out of the fire. You heard the sound of the words, but saw no form. There was only a voice. He declared to you his covenant, the Ten Commandments, which he commanded you to follow, and then wrote them on two stone tablets. And the Lord directed me at that time to teach you the decrees and the laws you are to follow in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And join with me in the words of a new creed, our affirmation of faith this morning. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Our hymn, O God of Bethel.
Thank you.
Amen, and please be seated. Let us pray. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 9. Only be careful and watch yourselves closely so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen, or let them slip from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to their children after them. Only be careful and do not forget. But how do we do that when there's almost, or we're getting very close to the point where there's hardly anyone left alive who saw with their own eyes, who experienced in their own lives the reality of war? The veterans, and pretty well anybody else from the First World War, are long gone. And the Second World War is certainly drifting further and further into the background of memory. Growing up, in Scotland, when I was the age of you guys, well, not you guys, but you guys sitting up front, it was after the war. But there were still the signs of the war all around us. When we went from my small country town into Glasgow a couple of times a year, you know, to do there's big shopping and the fancy stores, or maybe to go to the theater or a show, you still drove through parts of the city of Glasgow that were in ruins from the bombing of the Blitz and had never been rebuilt. My mother, who was your age during the war, still carried on her body the scars of shrapnel and broken glass, because she grew up, until she was evacuated, in Liverpool, in England, the second great port and the second target after London for the Blitz. And her street was bombed. And while there were still people running for shelter, and she was hit. And to the end of her life, in her mid-80s, she still had the scars on her legs from the shrapnel and the glass. It would take decades for her to actually speak about the war in anything but the vaguest terms. And she would be almost 80 before she was comfortable enough regaling and amazing her English grandchildren with the story of how one unexploded bomb came through the roof of her house and landed on her bed while she was in it. Growing up with her as my mother, I heard about the birthday cake, the glass also went into the birthday cake, and they hit her. I never heard about the bomb in the bed. How do we remember when the people who were there are no longer with us? And better still, how do we remember the lessons that they learned in such a hard, hard way? Sometimes the answer is as simple as keep on telling the stories. When I was newly minted as a minister and recruited from Scotland and sent to my first charge in Prince Edward Island, I was asked in I had four rural charges, four fishing villages and a farming community up in the hills. that was a Gaelic-speaking community still. And I was asked to go and visit a gentleman by the name of John Stewart, who lived in the farmhouse pretty well next door to the church, and was feeling a bit down. So I went to visit John Stewart, not realizing that he was a First World War veteran. And the reason he was feeling down was he was beginning in his late old age, he was in his late 80s, heading for 90, to being overwhelmed by the memories. So I sat in John Stewart's front room while he told me the story of how he, as a young soldier, about 18, 19 years old, serving in the frontline trenches in, I'm not sure if it was France or Flanders, but the frontline trenches, when shelling started and landed a direct hit on the edge of the trench that he and his friends from the Prince Edward Island Regiment were filling. And how he and they were buried by the collapsing trench. To be more accurate, how he, as the only survivor, was buried under the bodies of his friends and neighbors from Prince Edward Island, from school, from the farms around him, and lay there for hours, covered by his friends' bodies, waiting until someone, anyone, came to dig them out, lift them off, and help him out. That nightmare was his daily memory of the war. As a former military chaplain, it was my privilege and burden to hear veterans of the Second World War tell me, because I was a padre and not a member of the family, tell me the things that caused them nightmares that they shared with no one else. It changed their lives in a way that made them, for the most part, take up not the lest we forget, but the never again. No one in their right mind who has been there wants to go there again. That's the burden they lay upon us. That we don't let the stories be forgotten. We don't turn away our eyes or close our hearts, but from generation to generation, we remember, we tell the stories, and we reaffirm that the purpose of remembrance is not to glorify the past, but to recommit ourselves to a better future. God grant us grace to do both, to remember and to do better, for the sake of all of those who suffered and gave so much, well beyond anything they had imagined, that we might enjoy the freedom and the peace that we have today. Amen, and to God be glory and praise and power, now and forever. Let us pray. Let us, in honesty of heart, seek the Lord's renewing grace to deepen our wisdom and our peace, and to equip us as instruments of his kindness. God of goodness and truth, in this time of remembrance, we offer our broken spirits for your healing, our searching for your guiding light. God of light and love, you desire that all your people should live in your peace. Grant us then the humility to seek your forgiveness and the will to practice it in our dealings with others. Help us in days to come to seek the good of the world, to work for the increase of peace and justice, and to show tolerance and open-mindedness toward those whose character and customs differ from ours. Grant our remembrance this day may be consecrated for practical service, and the world made better for our children's children. Receive our prayers for the well-being of all people, especially those who mourn and are sad, and for all in distress, both known to us and unknown. Hear us for the peace of the world, for the wise resolution of conflicts and the release of captives and of oppressed people everywhere. Grant that the people of the world may do your will and live in your spirit, through that same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us praying together to say, Our Father. We continue to worship God as we present our gifts and offerings for the work of the kingdom here and around the world. The offering will now be received. Receive, O Lord, these our gifts and offerings, and with them ourselves, our souls and bodies, a living and acceptable sacrifice to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our hymn, O Day of Peace That Dimly Shines. Peace is not the product of terror or fear. Peace is not the silence of cemeteries. Peace is not the silence of violent repression. Peace is the generous, tranquil contribution of all to the good of all. Peace is dynamism. Peace is generosity. It is right and duty. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord, and the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you, both now and forevermore. Amen. If you have either the bullet or the bullet cross, please leave it on the lectern before you leave this morning. And please do join us for our time of fellowship and a pastor lunch, but remain standing while the scouts remove the colors.